just to, what are we doing? That's when you don't have?
Yeah, I thought we were only doing like.
I Use the orange mic and then give it to Kurt because you're not on. Or is that one on? Okay. All right. Make sure you give it back to me.
Which microphone
do you want? What? He's going to sing that. Okay. I'm just going to sing that. Well, there's my. You have to use this mic here. Just put it back on the stand because that's for Kurt. Yep, we're ready.
Well, good. Hello. Good evening. Can y'all hear me? No. Hello? Testing? Hello? Testing. 1, 2, 3.
It's working.
Okay, now. Can you guys hear? All right, we're all good. Good to see you all. It's exciting that, you know, the Christmas Eve candlelighting services are the best. And we've got a lot of people. We got some guests, some visitors. Thank you for being with us tonight. And so we are here to celebrate Jesus and keep him at the center of our thoughts during the Christmas celebration season. So we have a great service planned. And by the way, if you don't have a candle, they just come up and get, I mean, yeah, just come right on up or get one right here. And they'll get it, and so because we're going to do the candle lighting toward the end. So let's start with a word of prayer and let the worship team take it from there. Father, thank you for this time where we come to you and lift up Jesus. Say thank you to you for sending him to us. Jesus, thank you for what you did, not just coming as a child and growing and all that's teaching and life and then dying on the cross for us. Father, or Jesus, we thank you for that. And we are here tonight to lift you up, honor you, celebrate you, and put you first in our lives. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing some Christmas carols. That sound appropriate? I think so.
I think so.
I'll try to flip into the tenor part on this one.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains, Gloria in excelsis Deo. Strains prolong, what the gladsome tidings be, which inspire your heavenly song, Gloria in excelsis Deo. Come adore Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Gloria in excelsis Deo. While our hearts in love we raise, Gloria in excelsis Deo, Gloria in excelsis Deo. To certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so deep. Noel, Noel, Noel. Seek for a king was their intent, and to follow the star wherever it went. Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel. Still we see thee lie. silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. For Christ is born of Mary and gathered all above. While mortals sleep, the angels keep their watch of wandering love. Oh, morning stars together proclaim the holy birth, and praises sing to God our King, and peace among men on earth. How silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of his heaven. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Christ enters in. O lowly child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angel the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel.
Away in a manger, no
crib for a bed, the little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky, and stay by my cradle till morning is nigh. Be near me, Lord Jesus, I ask thee to stay close by me forever, and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care, and fit us for heaven to live with thee there.
You may be seated.
Luke 2, 1 through 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up to the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David.
He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him, and was expecting a child. While there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
Luke 2:10-12. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." With me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the greatest gift that you could ever give us. Thank you for sending your son, and thank you to Jesus for all he went through and all he did and died on the cross for us. Thank you for this beautiful Christmas Eve and all for all the people that are here with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would someday walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Mary, did you know? That your baby boy was Lord of all creation. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am. Ooh.
We're going to observe communion right now. And you might wonder, okay, on the eve of the Lord's birth, why would we be celebrating communion? Well, I don't know about you and your past history of getting gifts or something, or even giving gifts, but have you ever received the one that they said, this is a two-part gift? Well, God's gift to us was a two-part gift. One, his son, to take on a human body, live amongst us, teaching, preaching to us and all. And the second part is giving his life for us on the cross to forgive us of our sins so that we can be with him in heaven. So we are going to observe communion tonight, and I want you to think about that, that this is a wonderful time to celebrate God's son's birth, but also for what he did for us later in his life. Shall we pray? Father, we're just so grateful that every year we can gather together humbly, cheerfully, and just beautifully worship and praise the fact that you gave your son birth here on earth for each and every one of us. And Lord, also that later, because of our way of life, our living, our incompetence with dealing with things, we foul up all the time. Our sins, Lord, would have kept us from being with you in heaven. So you knew it was necessary to send your son to that cross, to die for us so that we can have a chance to live in heaven with you if we truly believe. Lord, we just want to thank you first again for giving us your child as a baby, watching him grow, teaching, preaching, building disciples. And then, Lord, the end of his life was the most miraculous thing. That yes, he died on that cross, but on the third day rose again. And Lord, we can look forward to that ourselves. We thank you in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace. Sleep in heavenly peace. Silent night, holy night, shepherds quake at the sight. Glory streams from heaven afar. Heavenly hosts sing alleluia. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born.
People said. Amen. Amen. That was awesome, guys. Now, let's see. How can I maneuver this? I'm going to move that right there. I'm going to stand right here. Good to see you guys all tonight. And so, this is our fifth Sunday of Advent, Christmas Eve. And on the Christmas Eve, we light the center Christ candle. And the others had different themes. And so, we worship Christ and because he's the one that's all about. This Advent season, we've been having some fun lining up Christmas movies with the various themes, okay? And so, you know, we've did Home Alone. We've done, what was the other one? Oh, Christmas Story, Home Alone, How the Grinch Stole Christmas. This morning, we did Charlie Brown Christmas. But tonight, I got to tell you, I'm at a loss because it's really hard to find a Christmas movie that lines up to Jesus. Charlie Brown Christmas is closest, but I was told this morning networks are dropping that because it's too religious. It's not politically correct. So that's even going out. In fact, I looked up the most watched Christmas movies. Here's the top 10 lineup. Home Alone, it's pretty good. Christmas Story, you know. Charlie Brown Christmas has a little bit of Jesus in there. It's a great, you know, Linus repeats the Christmas Story. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Elf. Okay, who hasn't watched Elf? Christmas Vacation, I don't see that one. It's a Wonderful Life. At least it's got angels. Okay, so you got, you know, you got that. The Santa Claus, Miracle on 34th, Die Hard is number 10. Yeah, it's like, what's that, you know? And, yeah, it's like, yeah, it's a thing. And so, but except for Charlie Brown Christmas, none of them have anything to do with Jesus. It's just not there. And there's just not a lot of room for Jesus in the movie world. And I got to thinking, well, in our society, there's not a lot of room for Jesus anywhere. He's just being edged out slowly but surely. And And so this evening, I want to encourage you and myself to make some room for Jesus, because that's what we're talking about. One of the more significant parts of the Christmas story is recorded in Luke. And this is what it says. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. And he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And then verse 7 is just classic. So she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in clothes, placed him in a manger, because there was no room for him in the inn. That part always gets to me. I mean, here's the Savior of the world. Here's the Lord of the universe. And there's no room at the inn? I mean, really? How sad is that? You know, it's like, he's the, you know, wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, and there's no room for Jesus. And we shake our heads and say, that ain't right. And yet, there's many people tonight, many places where there's no room for Jesus in our world. And I guess the real question I want to raise for us is there room for Jesus in our lives tonight and tomorrow? And the fact that you guys are here, praise God, because you're making room for Jesus. You're here, and that's good, but will you make room for him tomorrow and the next day? Because we live in a world where even those of us who love Jesus, it squeezes the room out. We got so much stuff going on, so many things going on. The room for Jesus gets smaller and smaller, and he just gets pushed out of our lives, and it's a battle to keep him at the center of what we say and do in the holiday seasons. And that's the problem. We have so much stuff to fill up our lives. I mean, you know, I'm embarrassed to tell you all I've been eating the last few days. It's like, it's crazy, you know. And so, man, I certainly don't need any more food. And of course, the busyness, it goes on. Decorations, how many you decorated, you know, fought with the Christmas lights? And any of you Christmas card people, I don't understand you, but that's okay. Do what you want to do. You know, that takes time. I mean, all the stuff we do. And Jesus just can sort of get pushed out of our lives with all the activity. Yet, if I were to transport you to a desert island where there was nothing, you know, no Starbucks, no Dutch Bros, no restaurants, no entertainment, no Wi-Fi, no iPhones, no Facebook, nothing. And you were there, had to hang out for a few days. Your wants and needs would get reduced to very few things, like food and water. I mean, it would become that. And if you went much longer and you're facing your final moments, you would realize that your needs and wants reduce even more to just one thing. You know, what's after? I'm going to die here. Is there anything after? And we realize we need something more than all the stuff that we enjoy during the holiday seasons. When I was young, 16, I went on a 21-day wilderness expedition in Colorado, and we had these, you know, we'd hike like 7 days and hit a supply thing, and at the end of the 7 days, we were out of food, and that's where I learned to eat tuna fish out of a can. I learned to like sardines. And you like sardines? I love them, but, and one for breakfast, we had onion soup mix, Lipton onions for breakfast. That was our breakfast. And all of a sudden, and I realized that time, it's funny how when you have things taken away from you, all of a sudden you don't need much. Even food doesn't have to be that great. But when you're looking at the end of your life, what do I really need? And I got to tell you, and this might be a shock to you, Christmas is not even about family. Okay, it's not even about kids and parents and all that stuff, and even that special someone, because they cannot meet the deepest need of your life. Only Jesus can. He's the one we need when all is stripped away. And, you know, we need to make room for Jesus, because he's the one thing we need. And there's a passage in the book of Revelation where Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone opens the door to him, I will come in and I will eat with him and dine with him and he with me. And You know, he's knocking at our door tonight. And the question is there room in our inn to let him in? Because we need him more than anything else. And will I let him in tomorrow? And will I let him in the next day? And some of you guys need Jesus to save you from your families this Christmas season. You're like, how am I going to endure my family? We need Jesus to save us from a lot of things. I ultimately need Jesus to save me from myself. That's the bottom line. And so I'm so glad when I make room for Jesus because he does that. And when he saves me from myself, it's amazing. I can have a little peace and contentment, even a little bit of joy, even when things don't go right. We've been having troubles with our sounds or our video, and things have been going wrong. And, you know, it's never perfect, right? It doesn't have to be because it's all good, because when you have Jesus, that's enough. And I got to tell you, I've said this before, until Jesus is enough, nothing is enough. Okay? And when Jesus is enough, nothing else is really necessary. That's what we need. But I have to make room for him. And so I don't know about you, but I'm going to make room for Jesus, and I want to encourage you to do the same. And that brings us to the candle lighting. Okay? And this is the special part of our service where we light the candles. And because there was no room at the inn, Mary and Joseph ended up taking shelter in this manger. You know, it's a structure for animals to hang out in. And so Jesus was basically born in a stable, right? And it said, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And of course, the angels showed up, scared the daylights out of these poor shepherds. But then they proclaimed to them the message of Jesus. They said, today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord, and this will be a sign to you. You'll find a baby wrapped in cloths lying in a manger. And then in Luke chapter 2, verse 16 and following, this is what it says after the angels talked to them. It says, they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And when they'd seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. I like the fact that the shepherds hurried off to see Jesus. Okay, they didn't stop, take a shower, get dressed up, and then go see Jesus. They didn't clean up the campsite for guests and then go see Jesus. They hurried off to see Jesus. They just went, and that's all they did. And so, you know, we hurry off to the mall. We hurry off to the coffee shop. We hurry off to a lot of things. Are we going to hurry off to Jesus? But the second part of this story is what I like the best. In the story itself, the shepherds, once they saw Jesus, they spread the word. Christmas is one of the best times to spread the word, to reflect Jesus, to pass on the light. Jesus is the light of God sent into our dark world. He is the light. Isaiah 9:2 says, a people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. And that's Jesus. And when we experience Jesus, we receive his light. But he never meant for us to keep that light in ourselves. He meant for us to pass it on and reflect him to others. And that's what the candle lighting represents. We experience the Christ candle, and then we pass it on to others by lighting each other's candles. Jesus says, you are the light of the world. Neither do people put a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Let your lights shine. Kurt?
Yep.
There you are.
Please join with me in singing Silent Night. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child. Holy infant, so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace.
light. Glory streams from heaven above. Heavenly hosts sing hallelujah. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born. Silent night, holy night, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from thy holy face, with the dawn of redeeming grace. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Our Father in heaven, we're so grateful to you, Lord. We can humbly come together and worship you. We can praise you. We can sing to you, Lord. We want to give our lives to you. And we just thank you for coming to earth, being amongst us, living and proclaiming that we too shall be with you in heaven someday. Lord, we just ask that as we go away from this place, that our minds do not go away from you, that we keep you in the forefront of our thoughts as we have our festive activities around us, Lord, and we show that love to others in our family and in our friends. Let them see you in us, Lord. We thank you for tonight. We thank you for all that we did to praise you, Lord. And we just ask for safe travels from here and festivities, Lord, that people can enjoy not only each other, but you in their lives. In thy name we pray. Amen.